Yeah, we're gonna change it up a little bit right here. What?
Amen. Anybody ready for the word this morning? Let me try that again. Is anybody ready for the word this morning? Amen. You're not clapping and getting excited for me, but we're getting excited for what God is going to speak to us this morning. Amen. Well, we are continuing our message series called Bright Future, where we are looking at the future and its implications for you and I in today's day and age. So we're coming out of the book of Revelation this morning, Revelations chapter 21, and we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 5. Again, that's Revelation chapter 21. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 5. I'll give you a minute to get there. Amen. Revelations 21, 1 through 5. Here's what the word of God says to us this morning. And these are the words of John the Revelator. He says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God.'" And it continues, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." I want you to look at the person next to you and say, "Passed away." Come on, look at somebody else and say, "Passed away." It's passed away. And in verse 5, it concludes with this. "He who was seated on the throne said, 'I am making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.'" For a few moments this morning, I would like to speak about, I make all things new. I make all things new. Let's pray this morning. God, we thank you for an opportunity to gather around your word. Thank you for bringing us together for this moment where you will speak to our hearts. God, I pray that you would open our minds. God, that we would have minds ready to listen and to comprehend. God, I pray that you would open our hearts, that we would have a willingness to change, that we wouldn't be content hearing this word and then remaining the same as we are. But God, I pray that this would be a moment of transformation. I pray that this would be a moment of encounter. Lord, I pray that I would decrease so that you can increase. And we thank you in advance for everything that you have for us, God. We pray these things in your name. Let the church say amen and amen. I can remember several years ago, I had an opportunity to go to an art museum where they had world-renowned art restorationists who had set up shop there, and they were repairing and restoring pieces of art that were from the medieval times, paintings and tapestries that had hung in castles in Europe for hundreds of years. Needless to say, these once beautiful pieces of artwork over the hundreds of years that they had been hanging up became covered in soot and dirt. The paint began to fade. The threads began to untangle. And by the time they had gotten to the art restorationists, these beautiful pieces of priceless artwork were seemingly beyond repair. They were broken. They were discolored. They were faded. Some might even conclude that rather than trying to fix them, it might simply be easier to throw them away. But the work of an art restorationist is to renew what is already there. It is to bring life back to things that seem to be falling apart. Its job is to breathe new life back into these priceless pieces of art. Now, as I was thinking about that this morning, it reminds me that You and I serve a God who is a great restorationist. Can I get a witness this morning? You see, God looks into our world and he sees our brokenness. He sees our pain and he sees what sin has done. And at times, I believe it grieves his heart. But because God is still the creator and he still cares for what he created, he doesn't just throw you and I out. No, no, no. He works with what's already there. We serve a God who restores what is already there. We serve a God who brings new life back to dead things. We serve a God who sees our broken world and he knows how to put it back together. Can I get a witness this morning? Because I know that God, he looks at you and I and he sees us in our brokenness and he sees us in our pain, but he knows how to put us back together again. We serve a God who is a renewalist expert. He knows how to breathe new life into things that are dying. We serve a God who works with what's already there. Today's passage comes from a very unique part of Scripture. It was written by this guy named John who had this vision from God about what was going to happen in the future. Now, it's a very complex book, the book of Revelation, because it speaks in a lot of symbols and in illustrative language. And it's trying to make the point that at the end of the day, things might get bad, things might get dark, but Jesus Christ will be Lord at the end of the day. It's trying to make the point in many different ways that at the end of the day, God is victorious and death loses out. It's trying to make the point that at the end of the day, God comes and takes back over the things that he created. It's a vision that God gave John. And in this part of the vision, John sees the end product. He sees what happens at the end of the day. And he says that he sees our world fully restored and fully renewed. He sees our world that was once dying and in conflict and in sin. He sees it full of life, full of purpose, and walking in God's promises for it. He says that I see the new world, the new heavens and the new earth, and it kind of looks like it does before, but something has gone away and something has taken its place. You might ask, what has gone away this morning? Death and sin have gone away and they've been replaced by God's presence in God's life. John sees the world and he sees the end of the story and he says, wow. God doesn't get rid of the broken world. He doesn't just kick it to the trash heap, but he comes and he renews the world just like he's going to renew you and I. And he gets deeper into the vision and he says, I see a city. I see a place that looks like Jerusalem, but it's a new Jerusalem. Somebody say New Jerusalem. There's a new Jerusalem, and it's at the center of the world where God dwells with his people. You see, in the Old Testament, Jerusalem had been that place where the temple was, and the temple was where God manifested himself with his people. But that was the only place that they could go in order to meet with God once a year through the high priest. But John says in this new Jerusalem, there's not a temple because the temple is now in the hearts of people. There's not a place that people have to go because instead of a temple, there is a presence of God everywhere. In this new Jerusalem, God is in the streets. He's in the woods. He's in the houses. And the people of God who are diverse from different languages and different ethnicities and different races and different economic classes, they're all together and the presence of God is within them. It's a wonderful, wonderful vision. But here's the thing that excites me the most when I read this passage. John says that in this new place, he looked around Sister Dilworth and he doesn't see death. John says he looks around and he doesn't see people mourning anymore. He looks around and he doesn't see death laying at anybody's door. He looks around and all he sees is the total presence of God and the total absence of death. You see, the new world, the new heavens and earth that you and I are promised is one that has no more sorrow. It has no more pain. It has no more brokenness. All it has is the total presence of God. And we know that where God is, things come together. We know that where God is, death has to flee. We know that where God is, there can only be life and death has to flee. Come on, somebody. There's a time coming and a future coming where we don't have to deal with with death anymore because it's been overwhelmed by God's life. You see, rather than getting rid of our broken world that's full of war, full of violence, full of sin, full of different ways that you and I have moved away from God, God doesn't get rid of our world. He renews what is already there. God doesn't get rid of you and I. He remakes us into better versions of ourselves. God doesn't just let death win, but he resurrects us into a new life. The name of our church is New Beginnings. Here's what we need to hear this morning. At the end of time, in the future, the thing that we have to look forward to is that everything has a new beginning in God. Everything is renewed in God. We're not going to suffer anymore. We're not going to worry no more because God's life has taken over. So what is the truth that we can find in this passage this morning? It's a simple one. It's a simple one, but it's one that we ought to take with us and write on our hearts day to day. It's this: God is on a mission to renew all things. Let me say that again, because this is the key point of today's message. God is on a mission to renew all things. I want you to look at the person next to you and say, neighbor, God renews all things. Look at somebody else across the aisle and say, neighbor, you look good today, but God is going to make you look better. We have a God who is renewing all things. We have a God who is making all things new. We have a God who is breathing life into things that were dying. And emerging out of this, there are three truths about God's renewal project this morning. The first truth is this: God is revitalizing his creation. God is revitalizing his creation. What does that mean? Just to say it plain, it means that God is returning things to their original purpose. You know, when God looks at our lives and he looks at our world, he sees how we've gone off track. He sees how life has become misshapen because of sin. And part of what God is doing in the future, and he's also doing it now, is God is putting things back on track. He's making things do what they were intended to do. I have some friends in the ministry who work in urban city renewal. And they come together with different parties and different agencies, and they come up with a plan on how to bring life back into different parts of the city that have had an increase in violence, and the businesses have left, and things have fallen into disrepair. And they come up with what's called a renewal plan that attempts to bring a part of the city back to life. And as they begin to rebuild buildings, and as they begin to have people come back and start businesses there, and they begin to empower the people who live there, life comes back into that part of the city. Likewise, we need to understand that when God becomes involved in our world and in our lives, he begins to call life back to things. He begins to call life back to you and I. He begins to call life back into our world. We have to understand that God calls us back to live. He doesn't call us to die, but he calls us to life. That's what it means when we say that God is revitalizing his creation. He's making all things new. He's calling it back to its original purpose. That's why Isaiah 65:17 says, "See, I create a new heavens and new earth." This means that the world begins to walk in its real purpose. Part of the future that you and I can look forward to is there's a day coming when we are going to be living in our real purpose, what God intended you to live in. But here's the good thing. You don't have to wait for some time in the future. God is calling you to live in your real purpose even now. And you can do it through the power of the Holy Spirit in you. God is revitalizing not only our world, but he's revitalizing your life this morning. So number one, we have to understand God is revitalizing his creation. But number two, we have to understand that in God making all things new, God is remaking his people. He's remaking his people. What does that mean? It simply means this: God is opening up his family to everyone who has been saved. No longer do you need to be born into a particular group of people, but God says, if you're the redeemed of the Lord, you have full access. If you're a son or daughter of the Most High, you have access into the kingdom. You see, this is the change that we see from the Old Testament to the New Testament. In the Old Testament, the people of God were Israel, the Jewish people. You had to be born in it. You couldn't join it. You had to be born in it. I know those of you who are Church of God in Christ think I'm quoting the Church of God Christ hymn. You got to be born in it. I'm not doing that. But in the Old Testament, the people of God were people who had a particular ethnic heritage. They were born into the people of God. What happens through Jesus Christ and in God making things all new, he opens up the people of God to people who are not Jewish. He opens up the people of God to people who are not under the covenant. And he says, if you have faith in my son, Jesus Christ, you're all good with us. You're a full citizen. You're a full member. You have a place in God's kingdom. You know, years ago when I was adopted, in talking with my parents, they made it very clear that they didn't just give me their name. But rather, when I showed up to their house as a newborn baby, I literally altered their life by my presence. All of a sudden, my parents, who were young, this couple with no children who went out on the weekends to plays and to sports games, now they had this baby that they had to feed. They had to account for me, and I had apparently my own schedule. And I'm told I'm about to find out babies have their own schedule in just a matter of weeks. My mother-in-law has assured me. But my dad was telling me that when I showed up, I completely changed their lives. They were no longer the same family. And we have to understand that likewise, when God adopts us, our relationships with one another begin to change. We have to understand that God makes things new by changing our relationships with one another. Part of God making our world renewed is that things begin to change how we interact with one another. There's no longer war, but there's peace. There's no longer violence, but there is agreement with one another. You see, when God makes things new and he renews the world, there's no reason for us to fight with one another, and we return to the original harmony that we had in the beginning. You see, the New Jerusalem that John is describing is a diverse group of people. There are Jews, there are non-Jews, there's Americans, there's non-Americans, there's Republican and Democrat, there's black and white, there's rich and poor, but they're all one people, and they can live together because the presence of God in each person changes how you interact with them, and you don't interact with them the way you did before. Think about what if the church began to look a little bit about like the New Jerusalem. Think about if this church was full of black and white, rich and poor, Republican and Democrat. Think about what this church would look like if we began to look a little bit like heaven. God is remaking his people. But here's the final point, and this is what excites me. Not only is God on a mission to renew all things by revitalizing his creation, not only is God remaking his people, but God is restoring his relationship to us. If you ask, what is it that really should excite us about the future? God is restoring his relationship with you and I. Just to say it plain, God is taking us back to Eden. Let me say that again. Part of what should excite us is that God is taking us back to Eden. Remember Eden, that place in Genesis chapter 2, where the first humans, they walk with God, they talk with God, they spend time with God. He's just there and they're good and things are as they should be. But we know that sin broke that relationship apart. Part of what God does in the future, and we begin to feel it in different ways even now, is God is taking us back to Eden. Somebody say back to Eden. God is taking us back to a place where we live in harmony with God, and he's a part of everything we do. God is taking us back to a place where we don't have a particular moment of the day where we go to meet with God, but he's just a part of everything that we do. It's like the old gospel hymn, we take the Lord with us wherever we go, the highways and the byways, God is just there. The reality is that you and I are all prodigal children. We're all people who have gone off on our own way in different ways. But here's the good news this morning. Even though you and I have a broken relationship with God on our own, we have a God who is calling us back into community and relationship with him. We have a God who is calling us back to be in relationship with him, to love him, to dedicate our lives to him. He's just like the father of the prodigal son. He didn't wait for the son to walk up that dirt road and get back to the house. What does the Bible say? It says that the father ran to the son. That's what we see in the future. God runs to you and I. He restores the relationship with you and I. He runs to us. He picks us up and he puts us back together. Echoing the commitment that he once made to Israel, it's as if in Revelation, John hears God saying that once again, we will be his people and he will be our God. We will be a special people because we have God at the center of our existence. It's as if God is tabernacling once again with his people and he's put a tent in the midst of us, and wherever the people of God are, there God can be found. So as I close my message this morning, I have a story that I want to share that I think helps illustrate the main point once again. It's this. My dad, when I was growing up, he was the district manager for a chain of convenience stores in Florida. And I can remember that my dad got a reputation for being able to take on the stores that were an absolute mess. Stores that were being financially mismanaged. Ones that, you know, there was trash everywhere. Things, you know, stores where they couldn't pay people enough to work there. My dad had a reputation for being able to take those stores on and turn them around. Now, for years, I thought what my dad did was go in and fire everybody and close the store down for a few weeks. In talking with my dad, he said, "Well, son, I didn't do that. What I did is I began to work with the people who were there and I began to pick up trash with them. And began to show them how to do an audit and how to organize the shelving in the back. Help them figure out the books. And we worked together and we reworked the store. We got it back on its feet. We set it on a new trajectory." When I think about that and think about today's message, I'm reminded that God steps into our mess and he sets everything right. We don't serve a God who comes in and destroys what is broken, but he mends what is broken. And just as God is mending our broken world, you can be assured that God is mending your heart this morning. You might be broken. You might have been in some dark places, but you should hear that you have a God who is the God who can mend broken things. Come on, somebody. We have a God this morning who comes in and he restores and he renews. And guess what? He doesn't just stop with us, but he goes into our neighborhood. He goes into the streets. He goes around our globe. Rather than discarding what is already there, we serve a God who renews the world around us. He does make all things new. He makes all things new. It doesn't say that he goes and gets new things, but he makes all things new. He makes me new. He makes our community new. He renews what is already there. What is it that we do with this truth as we walk out these doors this afternoon? There are three things that I think would be helpful. First thing, we should have a shift in how we think about God and what he's doing. We should know that our world and even our own lives are a new creation in God. That gives me hope when I look at my life and some of the things I'm not very happy about. It gives me hope knowing that God is making me a new creation every day. We should know that we are a work in progress. We should know that we serve a God who is breathing fresh life into us. We should know that truth and we should begin to walk in that truth. The second thing is this. This truth should change how we feel, what we feel in our hearts. You and I should feel hopeful. You and I should be able to look at the different things that we walk through and we should be able to say, trouble won't last always. You and I should be able to walk through some stuff and we know that God is able. You and I can look at the different situations that we may experience from time to time and we know that at the end of the day, God is victorious. You know, sometimes we got to pick up that bloodstained banner and we got to go fight, but we know that that fight is one that we're going to win because God is on our side. Amen. Not only should it change how we think and how we feel, but it should change what we do. Part of what makes us a Pentecostal people is we don't just believe that what is in God's word is just things that we can be happy about, but it should change what we do. Here's how it can change what we do. We can begin to live as a renewed people. We can begin to embrace that truth in the way that we talk to one another. we can begin to embrace that truth in the way that we go to work. I'm trying to learn to embrace it in the way that I'm a parent. Anybody know that parenting's hard? I'm trying to live as a renewed parent, and my son CJ's like, whatever, Dad, you got to keep working on that. But maybe your goal is to try to live as a renewed person in your marriage. When we begin to live as renewed people, it changes the world around us. God is a God who is renewing all things. He makes all things new. I don't know about you, but I look forward to that day when the new Jerusalem shall descend and the trump will sound, and God is going to renew this entire world. I'm so excited about it that I'm going to begin to live like I'm renewed even right now. And I hope that you join me, because I think that what God is looking for is a church that is the renewed people. So let me say it in the words of the old bishop: let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the renewed of the Lord say so. If you're renewed this morning, why don't you throw your hands up and say hallelujah? Why don't you say thank God for saving me? Amen. Why don't we give the Lord a hand clap of praise? He's good this morning. Amen. Would you join me in prayer? God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for your goodness. God, we thank you for your renewing work that you're doing in the world. God, I pray that as we prepare to leave this afternoon, that, Lord, we would be reminded that you are here to transform all things. Not only are you going to transform our world, but God, you're going to transform us. God, I pray that we wouldn't just wait for the future time when all this comes to its concrete conclusion, but God, we would begin to live out that renewal even now. Lord, we thank you that you are the God who renews what is already there. And we pray all these things in your name. Let the people of God say amen.